The Martin P6M SeaMaster was a strategic bomber flying boat built by the US Navy in the 1950s to form a strong and reliable nuclear weapons delivery system. After a series of accidents that led to substantial improvements and promising results, the aircraft was pitted against newer technology, having to prove its worth in the face of complex political turmoil. If successful, the SeaMaster would become the first large aircraft designed explicitly for high subsonic speeds near sea level. Nuclear threats. In the early 1950s, the U.S. Air Force's Strategic Air Command was the only means of delivering its nuclear arsenal. Meanwhile, the Navy's prestige was eclipsed by the Air Force, and its budget was at stake. The USS United States supercarrier was an attempt by the Navy to launch strategic bombers, but the project was canceled due to budget cuts in favor of the Air Force's B-36 bomber. The Navy then set out to build a striking seaplane force, consisting of jet-powered flying boats crafted for long-range nuclear bombing. They would also be used for conventional bombing, mine-laying, and reconnaissance tasks. In addition, seaplane tenders and fast submarines would provide support by staying close to the enemy. A requirement was issued in April of 1951 for a seaplane area to carry a 30,000-pound warload over 1,500 miles. The seaplane was to fly at low altitudes with a dash at Mach 0.9. Glenn L. Martin Company's proposal was chosen over Convair's, and the Navy ordered two prototypes. 6 pre-production and 24 production aircraft were to follow. The original version was planned to include the Curtiss-Wright turbo ramjet engine, a very ambitious development for the time. But it was later changed to a more conventional J-71A4 engine, which wouldn't measure up to the Seamaster's potential. The four engines were mounted in a pair of nacelles placed on top of the fuselage, near the wing roots. Additionally, some features were borrowed from the XB-51 bomber, including the T-tail and rotating bomb bay. The wings were swept 40 degrees and had a notable anhedral for stability on water. Aviation historian Jay Miller explained, quote, "It was designed with what is called an anhedral in the wing. An anhedral, instead of the wings being angled upward, the wings were actually angled down. And in so doing, it was possible to just mount floats permanently on the tips of the P-6M's wings." Test accidents. In December of 1954, the Seamaster rolled out of its hangar in complete secrecy. It featured an elegant and slender hull, plus the T-tail, a Martin trademark. During the following year, the beaching system was developed, which would play a key role in the P-6M's operations. Hence, the aircraft spent much of its time in the water. Taxiing tests were performed on smooth surfaces at first. It was later proven that the hull could endure 6 to 9 foot swells. Also, the hull's design kept the spray away from the T-tail. The cockpit, though, sat too low on the water, which gave the sensation of being in a submarine. Initial testing took place in Chesapeake Bay, near the company's headquarters in Baltimore. Early tryouts showed the engines were too close to the fuselage, even scorching it and causing cracks. A quick fix was devised, and 2 of the 4 afterburners were taken away from the engines. However, this change extended the takeoff time. Later versions would also have the engines angled outward. The first of 2 prototypes flew in July of 1955. Test pilot George Rodney remarked the experience was uneventful, which meant good news. In November of 1955, the Navy invited the press to take a look at the second prototype. After the demo flight, Chief of Naval Operations Admiral Arleigh Burke applauded the Seamaster's, quote, beautiful performance. Although successful at first, the seaplane had a crucial system fault in December, which destroyed the prototype. The Seamaster disintegrated in flight at 5,000 feet due to a malfunction of its horizontal tail, which caused the aircraft to make an outside loop at 9G stress before it crashed into the Potomac River. All the crew lost their lives. Testing resumed in May of 1956, after upgrading the T-tail and flight control instruments and installing ejection seats for the crew. Unfortunately, the second prototype was also destroyed near Odessa, Delaware, when it lost pitch control and failed to respond. This time, the crew ejected on time, but the seaplane broke down at 6,000 feet over the bay. New models. A year after the second accident, the YP-6M1 pre-production model was completed, with the nacelles now angled 5 degrees from the fuselage. Then, in January of 1958, testing resumed. By then, support vessels were already being refitted from 4 outmoded ships and a submarine. A special beaching cradle enabled the Y model to get in and out of the water with its own power. Military editor Hanson Baldwin admired its, quote, flexible operational capability with the world's oceans and lakes as its indestructible runways. The system also allowed the aircraft to taxi out of the water like a conventional land-based airplane, a notorious innovation for its time. Five more models were built, and the Navy announced the Harvey Point defense testing activity in Hertford, North Carolina, as the testing grounds. All the aircraft were fitted with a test version of the full combat suite, and were evaluated on bombing, mine-laying, and reconnaissance. In addition to its bombs and dozens of mines, two 20mm cannons were placed on the aircraft's rear in a remotely operated turret. It was also mounted with a high-altitude reconnaissance camera and a photo flash for its missions. However, it turned out that the J-71 engines were unreliable, and the takeoff was limited to perfect conditions. Several other control deficiencies arose, which led to program cuts. The P6M-1 was no longer considered successful enough to be developed. The program's fate. The Navy and Martin deemed the new P6M-2 version would provide a serviceable aircraft, and the first one was ready by early 1959. The model featured more powerful Pratt & Whitney J-75 P2 turbojet engines, with no afterburner that would scorch the fuselage, an aerial refueling probe, improved avionics, a high-visibility canopy, and a probe and drogue kit developed to fit the bomb bay were also implemented. The added weight made the aircraft sink lower in the water, eliminating the need for wing anhedral. Three aircraft had been built by the summer, and their performance was impressive. Their top altitude speed was Mach 0.89, rendering it faster than the contemporary U.S. Air Force B-47, which could reach Mach 0.78. Naval aviators were excited about the Seamaster's potential as a mine layer. They even believed it could mine the Black Sea and attack Soviet submarines before they left port. But more issues suddenly surfaced. The heavily built skin was over an inch thick, and the former pleasant maneuverability disappeared. The Seamaster now showed compressibility effects above Mach 0.8, including rapid changes in directional trim, severe buffeting, and wing drop that required high control inputs to counteract the effects. All of these problems needed to be fixed before the seaplane could be launched, and it was discovered that they came from the larger nacelles that held the larger engines. Even though the problems were fixed, the engineers and designers had run out of time. The first crews were already training for the Seamaster's operational debut when President Dwight D. Eisenhower's defense cuts forced the Navy to make drastic choices. Seaplanes comprised merely a tiny fraction of the Navy's fleet, and the Seamaster program was falling over budget and way behind schedule. In addition, a potentially superior nuclear strike system in the form of the ballistic missile submarines was being hatched, and they would cover the role of nuclear delivery systems. The Navy had also found cheaper ways to lay mines than manned bombers, and the Seamaster was directly competing with aircraft carriers for funding. The project was abruptly canceled in August of 1959. New York Times military editor Hanson Baldwin would claim, quote, "The Navy has reduced its once hopeful Martin Seamaster project rather drastically." Left behind. The initial production of 24 aircraft was reduced to 18, and finally to 8. The $400 million budget was not justified anymore. The company tried to market the Seamaster's technology in the civilian market as an 8-engine airliner called the Sea Mistress, but they were unsuccessful. Martin also considered developing nuclear-powered flying boats, but eventually gave up entirely on aircraft construction. Instead, it focused on developing missiles and military electronics. The Seamaster was the last aircraft built by Glenn L. Martin Company. All existing models were scrapped, but two tails, a fuselage piece, and a wing can be seen at the Glenn L. Martin Maryland Aviation Museum in Baltimore. Also, four wingtip floats still remain in the form of a catamaran built by an employee. The Seamaster's true potential was never exploited, nor the hype ever sustained. What remains are, again, only Hanson Baldwin's words on the aircraft's, quote, "flexible operational capability with the world's oceans and lakes as its indestructible runways." Please give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed this video, and leave your comments in the section below. Also, don't forget to subscribe to our channels for more informative historical content.